Students for leading us. That was great. So this morning, for those of you visiting, we have just finished Genesis. We did the entire book of Genesis together on Sunday mornings. We're in it for about a year. Scattered into that, we've been talking about spiritual disciplines. We've been calling them spiritual practices. And this might be our last one for the year, looking at kind of preaching schedule and our schedule. But these practices are rhythms and habits that you can add to your life in order to help you live the way Jesus lived. That is his call to every one of us in this room, and it's his call to every person on the planet to live the way that he lived. The different aspects of that life have been traditionally called spiritual disciplines. Before we get into it this morning, let me pray again as we get into the Word. Lord, I thank you for letting us gather around your Word. Lord, as we open it, I pray that you would fill us all with your Spirit to open up our hearts so we can see what's in your Word. Lord, I ask that you fill me with your Spirit so I can speak with clarity this morning. And Lord, it's our desire that you would be here with us and lead us to where you want us to be this morning, which is at your side where there's abundant joy and eternal pleasure. We ask that you do that in us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Open up with me to Matthew 11. 28 through 30. I didn't put the page in the Pew Bible up there this time. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. This has been kind of our flagship verse for looking at spiritual disciplines. It's a very common verse. A lot of people have heard it. Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take up my yoke and learn from me, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is one of Jesus' amazing invitations to us. And what he's doing here is he's inviting you to live a certain way. A yoke is what animals wear in order to bear a load or a burden. And he is saying, I have a way of bearing a load, of bearing a burden that I want to offer to you. I have a way of living life that I'm offering to you. He is inviting you to live a certain way. He's inviting us to learn from the way he handled life, and he offers that way to us. And if we live in this way, if we take on his yoke, we will find rest for our souls. That's a wonderful invitation. Wonderful invitation. We are calling the different elements of this life spiritual practices. We've gone through several. Today, I thought in preparation for Thanksgiving, in preparation for our progressive dinner tonight with our sister churches, we're looking at the spiritual practice of feasting together. Of all the spiritual practices, I think this is one that we do well. We all know how to eat well. We're all good Midwest people. Meals are a focal point of our life. Sharing a meal together is a spiritual experience, and Jesus calls us to make it a spiritual practice of our lives. Sharing meals together has always had a special place in my heart. I was blessed to grow up in an incredibly stable family of faith at every generation. And growing up, meals were the centerpiece of all of our family gatherings and holidays. I would argue that my family mastered the art of feasting together. My earliest memories of holidays are not presents I got, but vivid recollections of the fellowship that we shared around the dinner table. My grandma, Marilyn Johnson, who passed away almost 10 years ago now, she could work magic in her small kitchen. She was a single mother of my dad and my aunt after Grandpa died suddenly when my dad was only about 6 years old. So she raised my dad and my aunt by herself. She never remarried. And in her little house in Dassel, Minnesota, she got more out of the smallest kitchen I've ever seen than any chef has out of an industrial kitchen at a restaurant. I can remember her stove. It was straight out of the early 50s when they built the house. It was the same stove there the whole time. She had to light it with a match. There was no electric start on it. So she had this little tin box of matches on the stove all the time. And the aroma of the match smoke and the flicker of the flame as it started under that griddle always meant that Swedish pancakes were on the way. And we would just inhale them as they came off the griddle. They just kept coming. Those are Saturday mornings at Grandma's. And somehow in this small kitchen with a stove that could barely fit a large frozen pizza now, she would bring forth a feast every holiday. Swedish meatballs, turkey, mashed potatoes, potato sausage, lutefisk, lefse, sweet potatoes, and an endless variety of pies. This food was amazing, and somehow, I don't know how she did this, somehow it all arrived at the table warm and fresh out of this one oven. But they were not the centerpiece. The food was just the platform. The centerpiece was the fellowship. We would use this food to spend most of the day and evening sitting around the table, laughing, talking, and sharing. My grandma and her sisters would bring us all into a world of love and peace and joy. My grandma Marilyn and her sisters, Aunt Gloria, Aunt Margaret, Aunt Roseanne, and Aunt Ruth, would all gather around and talk. And as a little boy, I would just sit and watch. Laugh as they shared about stories of growing up together as sisters in the 30s during the Depression, in the 40s as they were teenagers during the Second World War. I would laugh as they shared stories of my dad and my aunt when they were growing up. My great aunt Ruth, who was the youngest of those sisters, just passed away last weekend in her 90s. In Indianapolis. At the time, we didn't realize we as a family had mastered the spiritual practice of feasting together. Maybe they did. They may have known what was going on. But me as a little boy, I didn't realize the significance of what I was experiencing. Together around the table, I learned what it meant to share a meal together. I learned what it meant to be a family together. What it looked like to have healthy relationships. What it looked like to care for one another. What it looked like to serve one another, and what it looked like to enjoy one another. And that's a lesson and a gift that cannot be overvalued. And it cannot be given or learned in any other way other than over a relaxing meal together as a family. The art of sharing a meal together is something that's quickly becoming lost in our culture. Gathering around a meal in which the only agenda is to enjoy each other's company, encourage each other, serve each other food. It does something to the soul. And I think we as Christians, it's our duty to relearn how to share meals together as a family. This was always seen in Jesus' life. Jesus was always feasting. Now, this is oversimplified, but I've heard it said you could summarize Jesus' life and ministry in two ways. He was either on his way to a party, or he was on his way from a party. And that's when all the stories happen that we read about. He's either going to a party and something happens, or he's on his way from a party and something happens. Jesus knew how to feast, and he knew how to celebrate. The local pastors at the time kept accusing him of eating with people he shouldn't be hanging out with. They accused him of being a drunkard because of all the parties he went to. They also got upset with him and his disciples because they never fasted while Jesus was there. They were always eating. Jesus' response was, "You don't fast when the bridegroom is here. You celebrate." Jesus knew how to feast. Feasting has been a very important part of history. Especially in Jewish history, feasting is very important in the Jewish religion. Of the 9 major Jewish festivals and holidays, 7 of them revolve around sharing a meal together as the centerpiece of that celebration. And think of our culture. How many of our holidays end up revolving around meals? Most of them. Thanksgiving is about a meal. What would Thanksgiving be without the Thanksgiving meal? Christmas organizes itself around the Christmas dinner. Even presents have to wait until dinner is done and the dishes are cleaned. I remember being annoyed at that. Biblically, there's another interesting element to this too. Think about this. We just finished Genesis. What was the first story in the book of Genesis? Adam and Eve eating together. That's the first event after creation. Adam and Eve share a meal together. It did not go well. That was not a good meal. A lot of damage flew from that meal afterwards. A lot of consequences, a lot of hurt flowed out of the sharing of that food. But all of history is going to unfold before us. And at the end of time, where are we going to end up? In heaven with Jesus, where and doing what? At a celebration dinner. A celebration dinner with wine for everyone. The place we are headed is a celebration dinner with Jesus at the head of the table. That song that we sang this morning, when we arrive at eternity's shore, when death is just a memory and tears are no more, we'll enter in as the wedding bells ring. His bride will come together and we'll sing, "You're beautiful." It's a dinner. That's where we're headed. A dinner together. And he's waiting for you. Before the dinner starts, he's waiting for you to get there. The story of God, the story of his work with humanity begins with a shared meal, and it ends with a shared meal. Sharing meals together is an important thing in human existence. Business deals are made over meals. Negotiations are had over meals. Treaties are signed over meals. Dating relationships focus around shared meals. Romance often involves sharing meals. The first intimate connection we have in our lives is with our mother sharing a meal. Sharing meals is fundamental to human existence. And I would argue it is fundamental to human flourishing. If we forget how to share meals together, we don't have much left. It's fundamental to the meaning of our existence. And we can prove it. I mean, take a billionaire. Take a billionaire. He lacks nothing. Can buy whatever he wants. Do whatever he wants. But he has no one to share dinner with at the end of each day. If you were honest with yourselves and really thought about it, we would say, "I don't envy his billions. I would take dinner with family. dinner with loved ones, if it was between the two. At a normal daily level, sharing a meal together as a family was quickly becoming a thing of the past. But this was one good thing that came out of the pandemic. With restaurants either closed or kind of hard to eat at, the family dinner at home came back. The pandemic brought back family dinner. But even after that quick rise, more than 50% of parents report that they have four or less meals together as a family each week. In a survey, September of 2022, 67% of people said that sharing a meal reminds them of the importance of connecting with other people, and it reminds them to slow down and take a break. Those are two very important things. Make connections with people and slow down and take a break. Another study from 2022 said for girls, better family meal environment at age 6 predicted an earlier bedtime, lower consumption of soft drinks and sweet snacks, and more classroom engagement, and fewer behavior problems at age 12. In the same study for boys, along with those things, it also predicted that there was less anxiety and more pro-social behavior in boys age 12. Family dinners are important for our development and psychology. Regular family meals are also linked to a reduction in substance abuse and an increase in just general mental health in adolescence if you regularly have meals together. I would argue that all of these things occur because relationships deepen over a meal, even with your own kids. Things are talked about over a meal that wouldn't be talked about without it. Think of how much of our life revolves around food. It's pretty startling if you think of it. You spend hours a day eating and preparing food to eat. Every day. What else do you do every day that encompasses so much of your time and forethought and planning? There's very little. Food is an inseparable part of our existence because we're physical beings that require food to keep moving. We need food for sustenance. And what Jesus teaches us to do is bring that into the spiritual as well. Make your meals a spiritual practice. You can eat many meals without it affecting you spiritually in any way. Most of our meals probably fall into that category. They just happen out of practicality and necessity. You have so much time for a lunch break at work, so you got to get your meal in. You got to get breakfast set for the kids before they go out the door to school. Many of our meals just take on practicality. A meal shared in fellowship is a deep spiritual experience. That is the heart of this practice. Have a meal whose purpose is not only enjoying the food, but whose purpose is the enjoyment of the fellowship that happens over the food. Because that's also a feast. This is key, and here's how you should think about it. A meal that happens in this way, it sustains you on kind of two planes. One, you take in great food that fills you up. That's the physical. But two, you also take in great fellowship that fills and satisfies your soul. And when those two things happen, the meal becomes a source of joy and rejuvenation. But it's not easy. Having great conversations over a meal is not easy. It's an art that needs to be learned and practiced. That's why these are called spiritual practices. But these types of meals are not just the time to take in food. But at a deep level, both physically and spiritually, you are filled. When you have a great and relaxing meal with friends or family, and you have a great time of fellowship, you come away rested and at peace. Like the yoke that Jesus offered us. Those are the memories I have of holiday meals together as a kid. Just peaceful rest. The spiritual practice of feasting is to intentionally create a space for those moments in your life. Intentionally create space for long, fellowship-filled meals together. To have mealtimes that aren't just about getting dinner on the table, but are about connecting as a family, catching up on life, checking in to see how our souls are doing. That is the spiritual practice of feasting. You do a soul check over a meal. I think the important part for us in our current context is to relearn how not to be hurried. If you remember, well, you probably don't, it's probably over a year ago now. There's a quote from a book I read. Dallas Willard was on a phone call with another pastor. The pastor was like, what do I need to do to just maintain my spiritual health? Dallas Willard thought for a second, and he said, hurry is the great enemy of the spiritual life. Ruthlessly eliminate hurry from your life. That's it. That's valuable. I think we need to relearn how not to be hurried. Because that's what life is now in this digital world. It's hurried. What's important is whatever is loudest and most often. And that's not a good scale to look at what's important. Learn how not to be hurried when we eat together. Now, this can't always happen. More often than not, we have schedules to keep, evening sports or events to get to, house projects, chores that need to be done before we go to bed. But I do think we need to work at getting at least a couple non-hurried meals in each week so we can just sit and enjoy each other. This is where we struggle as a family. I have no idea why we have two kids that are so high energy, because Jen and I are not high energy. I'm not sure where they came from. But Jen, we're just praying that this third one is the laziest baby ever, because I don't think we can take another crazy one. But with the ages of our kids, it's not hard for us to have a meal together. They can't make meals on their own, so we have to make it for them, and we all sit down and eat together. So we have to have meals together every night. But even on evenings when we have nothing scheduled, it still feels rushed. It still feels busy. It still feels hurried. It still feels too practical. We need to learn how to slow down. Well, that's easier said than done with the age of our kids. A couple key points to think about as we come to the end here. Make your meals both physically and spiritually filling. That is the spiritual practice of feasting. Don't only think about the food, but think about how are we going to be together while we eat this? What are we going to talk about? Where should our souls be when we share this meal together? Make your meals both physically and spiritually filling. As many of them as possible in a week. You can't do it with every meal. It's just not practical. Make them more than just food. Make them your connection time as a family. And the second thing, make the dinner table more than just the place where you eat. Try to shape it into the place where you talk, where that is the feast that you gather around, where you can exist as an uninterrupted family an uninterrupted family. How often do we allow ourselves to be uninterrupted together these days? Very little. Make meals your time to be uninterrupted together as a family. Turn off the TV, turn off the phones. Be together over a meal and talk about your soul together. That is the spiritual practice of feasting. There's another element of this one that we'll talk about this morning as well. As a church, as believers, we have a feast that we gather around regularly. And it's very different from any other meal that you share. It's very different. If you have a meal like this, you're strange. Crackers and grape juice as the main course, that's a weird meal. It looks like no other feast you have had. You share it with your brothers and sisters in Christ. We gather around the Lord's table. Now, the thing about this feast is this is the other end. Typically, we have feasts that are all about the food, and that's good. This feast is on the other end. This feast is purely spiritual. We do not feed ourselves physically with this meal. It is a spiritual meal. But it should be just as rejuvenating and just as sustaining as we share the Lord's Supper. We're reminded of what sustains us spiritually. That's the purpose. When we eat, we enjoy the food that sustains us physically through the day. When we eat this meal, we remind ourselves of what spiritually sustains us, what spiritually connects us back to God. In the same way food gives us energy to keep us going, communion reminds us that Jesus and what he did for us on the cross is what keeps us alive spiritually. Instead of savoring the flavors of the food together, we join together to savor what God has done for our souls, represented by these little portions of food. And the flavors are endless. All the different aspects of what Jesus does for us through the gospel. The forgiveness of our sins, our union together as his church, the body of Christ, our soul being set free from bondage, so many other things. All of these flavors come together in a spiritual meal that we share together in communion. The Lord's Supper is our true Thanksgiving dinner. That's the real Thanksgiving dinner. We share it together. There is a time in communion for us to be sober and reflective. There's a time for that, often. But there's also a time in communion for it to be celebratory. For us to smile when we share it together. It's okay to look at each other and smile. In communion, we're remembering the forgiveness of our sins and our reconciliation to God. It's okay to smile. This is a celebration dinner of a different sort. It's okay to smile with each other as we pass the bread and the cup. Be happy and give thanks that you are saved. This is our celebration dinner that we share together spiritually. Let me pray as those helping with communion can come up. Let me pray as they come up. Lord, we do thank you for this feast that we can share together. Lord, I pray that we would remember what you've done, that this would be a spiritual feast to fill us. Lord, we just thank you for the reality that this represents. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll pass the cup and then we'll take that together after I pray. Jesus took the cup of wine, that's what they're having. They shared it together. And one thing he said, is he said, I will not drink wine. He said, I will not taste of the vine until I share it with you when we're in paradise. Think about that. Jesus is waiting for his next cup of wine for you to get there and share it with him at that feast. Think about that as we share this together. Now you are still going to be hungry after you eat this. This is not going to fill you up physically. But as we take it together, remind yourself of what we share. Jesus gave his body for us, and we all, through the Spirit, are a part of that body as we share it together. Let that fill you spiritually. Let's take it together. Lord, we do thank you for this strange sacrament that you've given us, where we share together in a symbolic meal that fills us spiritually. We thank you for what you did for us on the cross, for giving yourself for us, for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, I pray that we could live out the gospel in our lives for your sake and for those around us. That's our hope. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. I have just a couple announcements here as we close. Progressive dinner tonight. We did have an RSVP sheet, but that was just to kind of give us rough numbers. So if you didn't RSVP, you can still come if you want. But it's going to start at 5 p.m. at Faith Hill Assembly, is where we're going to be having appetizers. And then we head down to Grace Chapel for the main course. And then back here for dessert, probably around 7 would be my guess. So it's a reminder that that's tonight. Also, Sunday school-wise, we're doing a Sunday school Christmas party on Sunday, December 17th after the service. So it will be in place of Sunday school for all kids, students, and parents, so all the families can come. It will be for fun and some games and stuff there, too. I believe that is it for events. We had a busy October, so we intentionally did a lot less in November. In the back of the sanctuary are giving boxes. You can put tithes and offerings there any point in the morning. Let me pray for that as we close, and then students can head out for Sunday school. Let's give the FHL students time to break down stuff in here before the high schoolers meet for Sunday school in here. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for all that you give us. Everything we have is yours, and you give it to us to steward. Lord, out of that, we offer it back to you. We pray that you would take what we give and multiply it for the work of the gospel. And Lord, we lift up our prayer again this morning that you would open the eyes of people in Bagley and Clearwater County to your gospel. Open their eyes up to you, and Lord, we pray that you would raise up workers for the harvest that you have here. And help us know how we can join in with that. We lift these things up in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good week, and thanks again, students from FHL, for leading. Thanks.